Good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Seana Robinson, MSP, on the Scottish Government's medium-term financial strategy and the Scottish Fiscal Commission's economic and fiscal forecasts May 2023 and her priorities under the First Minister's policy prospectus. Ms Robinson is joined by Scottish Government officials, Cathy Johnson, Deputy Director, Office of the Chief Economic Advisor, Alison Cumming, Director of Budget and Public Spending, and Andrew Scott, Director of Tax and Revenues. So welcome all to the meeting, and I invite Ms Robinson to give a short opening statement.
Thanks very much, convener, and thanks to the committee for inviting me here today. This is, as I said in the chamber, my first MTFS publication as Cabinet Secretary for Finance. It's transparent about the issues that we face as we look at the public finances over the next 5 years and sets out how this government will maintain a sustainable financial position over the medium term. Although the Scottish economy has proven more resilient than expected, the fiscal outlook remains among the most challenging since devolution, with the COVID pandemic, the war in Ukraine, soaring inflation, putting significant pressures on the economy, society and, of course, the public finances. We are committed to tackling these head on, which is why I ensure that the MTFS does not shy away from highlighting the scale of the challenge ahead. And while I welcome the recent fall in inflation, falling inflation does not reverse the increasing pressure on households and businesses, with prices expected to be around 20% higher by the end of 2023 than they were at the start of 2020. Indeed, we are experiencing record falls in living standards, which are not set to recover to pre-pandemic levels until around 2026-27. With regards to the Scottish Government's resource funding outlook, this has improved since the 2022 MTFS. The main drivers for this are significant improvement in the forecast net tax position, which has increased by an average of £1.1 billion per year since May 2022, as well as increases to the block grant as a result of announcements at the autumn statement and spring budget. However, the funding outlook for the next financial year, 2024-25, is set to be particularly challenging, with the SFC stating that once we account for Social Security spending plans and ring-fenced Scottish Local Authority funding, we expect there to be less real-terms funding in 2024-25 than there is in 2023-24. We are anticipating a negative tax reconciliation, currently forecast to be £687 million, with the original forecast produced at a time of significant economic uncertainty caused by the COVID-19 pandemic. This exceeds the government's borrowing limit by £387 million and so reduces the amount of funding available for the budget. We also expect a small real-terms reduction in the block grant next year. The risk of reconciliations for forecast error exceeding government's borrowing limits will continue to grow. Borrowing powers are fixed in nominal terms, and so there's now between a 14 and 27% probability of total negative reconciliations breaching the £300 million annual borrowing powers for forecast error. So I will continue to press the UK Government for further powers and for these limitations to be addressed as part of the fiscal framework review. In terms of resource spending, our projections show spending increasing from £45.2 billion in 23-24 to £52.8 billion in 27-28, meaning our spending requirements could exceed our central funding projections by £1 billion in 2024-25, rising to £1.9 billion in 27-28. The key drivers for spending growth are the public sector pay bill, Social Security and health and social care. Inflation has significantly eroded our spending power, particularly on pay, with fairer pay deals for our valued public sector workers to support them through the cost of living crisis, driving spend above what was modelled at the resource spending review. The pressures are also severe for capital spending, where the price of infrastructure projects has risen by 14.1% this year, according to the Office for National Statistics. The UK government's failure to inflation-proof our capital budget means we are facing a real terms cut every year up to 2027-28. Again, the challenge is particularly acute in 2024-25, where funding will reduce by 3.7% in real terms. On the current trajectory, we expect the divergence between capital funding and expenditure to grow to around £900 million by 2025-26. These are therefore incredibly challenging times, and I'm committed to taking the difficult decisions in order to manage our public finances over the medium term, to deliver on the key priorities for the people of Scotland and to mitigate the pressures being felt by the most vulnerable people in Scotland. This MTFS sets out the three pillars that will underpin this approach. Firstly, focusing on public spending, on achieving our three critical missions. This includes a commitment to prioritise, exploring targeting, adopting a multi-year approach to the budget, delivering a refreshed set of actions as initially set out in the resource spending review, and delivering a 10-year programme of public service reform. The second is supporting business to invest and create new jobs. We recognise the link between economic and fiscal policy to support sustainable, inclusive growth and the generation of tax revenues, as well as supporting entrepreneurs, start-ups and scale-ups and helping business to raise productivity. We need to find the fiscal headroom to expand our childcare offer, as this will be a key part of our approach. And finally, the third pillar of our approach is maintaining and developing our strategic approach to tax policy. Our key commitments here include establishing an external tax advisory group this summer, with the outcomes of this feeding into the budget for next year, and the government's longer term tax strategy to be published alongside the MTFS in 2024. So to conclude, convener, the Scottish Government will continue to do everything possible within the limited levers we possess to manage our public finances on a sustainable trajectory. And as part of the fiscal framework review, we will continue to make the case for the fiscal powers and levers that will enable us to meet the fiscal challenges now and into the future. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And well, you've covered quite a lot of ground, and there's quite a lot of ground for us, the committee, to cover as well. So we have about 15 minutes for each member to be asking questions, obviously including the answers. So if I could start off, you mentioned quite a key figure, which is next year's budget and the potential negative income tax reconciliation. I think £712 million or £687 million, I think, is perhaps the taxes in total. So can you give us a little more explanation as to how you are thinking of dealing with that, and particularly, can some be borrowed and can some, where's the rest going to come from? And we'll direct our questions to yourself if you want to bring in officials. That's up to yourself.
Yeah, so clearly this is very challenging, given that the levers we have do not allow us to cover that extent of negative tax reconciliation. We have the ability to cover up to £300 million at the present time, which leaves a gap, a considerable gap. And that is a challenge. So, as you can imagine, it is one of the key priorities in discussions with the UK government around the reform of the fiscal framework review. We I think, require a number of additional levers to be able to manage not just negative tax reconciliation, but the peaks and troughs, the economic challenges, events like COVID and other shocks that really we do not have the levers to deal with on a largely fixed budget with limited borrowing powers. So top of the list in terms of that review is to gain a more expansive borrowing power to be able to manage the negative tax reconciliation. I should say, yeah, as I said in my opening statement, the reason that negative tax reconciliation is so large was in relation to the forecasts during COVID, which clearly were clearly out given the economic shock at that time. But 2 years later, we have to deal with that. And we will want to press the UK government in our discussions with them to get to a position where we have more flexibility to deal with next year's negative tax reconciliation. But should that arise in the future, that we will be able to do that as well. I should also, just for completeness, say that we are anticipating that the tax reconciliation forecast is in a much more positive position going forward beyond next year, but we have to deal with next year.
Okay, I mean, that's again raised a range of issues, and I think colleagues will come in on different things when they get their turn. But, I mean, you've mentioned there for the fiscal framework review. I mean, can you give us any idea about the timescale for that? And, I mean, is there any chance that anything could be done before the 24-25 budget? Because that looks like being a pretty crucial one. And, I mean, even would it be possible to separate out some of the longer-term issues? But, I mean, getting this borrowing limit and some of these figures changed is quite urgent, obviously. And I think we've discussed in committee before that, and with the Fiscal Commission, that, you know, really just inflation and the increase in the Scottish Government powers, the £300 million is really out of date, isn't it?
So our priorities heading into the review, which, you know, we're discussing with the UK Government, so it's imminent, are to ensure that the, you know, the bullet grant adjustment methodology continues to protect the Scottish budget from potential slower population growth in Scotland. That's important. And to secure that greater budgetary flexibility and, you know, the appropriate and required budget management tools more generally, and, you know, to retain protection from economic shocks that affect the Scottish and UK economies equally, and to, you know, ensure that we have the appropriate suite of policy levers and that we're not unduly exposed to risks outside of our control. So, you know, those are the starting points. You'll appreciate that it is a negotiation, and negotiations are require give and take both ways, but those will be the kind of central areas that we require to see progress on. Whether we can get something in place for next year's budget really depends on how those negotiations go. We are entering them in good faith. The committee will appreciate that a negotiation requires, and UK government have very much asked for that to be in a private space. But I would want to share with the committee and Parliament more generally information that, you know, once that negotiation has reached a point, as soon as I'm able to provide more information, I would obviously want to do that. But that's difficult. We can't have a running commentary on a negotiation, I guess, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, I mean, I think we accept that we can't have a running commentary, but you know, I think both ourselves and, frankly, at Westminster, the committees do need to be doing a certain amount of scrutinising. Mm-hmm. I mean, can you give us any idea of timescales on this? Because the report, I believe, has been completed, the initial report, but hasn't been published. There's then meant to be a review, and then the negotiations are after that?
So, in terms of the report, we are still in discussions about a suitable date for publication with HMT. And, obviously, it was a jointly commissioned report, so we need to agree jointly the publication date, but we are committed to publishing the report. There's no question about that. It's just about when. We are in the foothills of those negotiations, so they're imminent, and we've been having correspondence backwards and forwards trying to shape what that discussion will look like. And, you know, I am keen to be as open as I can, but I am mindful that, you know, a negotiation is quite tricky, and we've got our asks, and the UK government will no doubt have its asks as well. So I will give, you know, a commitment, convener, that I will try to provide the committee with as much information as early as I can around the detail as quickly as I can.
I mean, can you say anything about any more of the, you know, the issues? I mean, borrowing, absolutely, clearly, we've mentioned, we've seen that already. I mean, capital borrowing would be another one. I mean, there's already issues sitting in the background which have not been dealt with, like air departure tax and VAT and so on. Are you expecting these to be part of negotiations?
So there are other issues around the use of the reserve and so on and so forth. In terms of air departure tax, we don't envisage that being a part of the discussions. VAT and assignment has been around for quite some time, and a lot of work has been done around some of the challenges around that assignment. I guess if I can describe it as a very challenging thing to do, where assignments have no direct relationship to the economic performance of Scotland. You're really looking at a kind of statistical exercise, and there are inherent risks in that. And we, of course, would be very loath to take all the risks without any of the policy levers. So those discussions are ongoing. I think the UK government, to be fair, recognise the complexity of that and the risks, and therefore we're trying to find a way forward that doesn't provide just another area of difficulty. I'm hopeful that we can get to some agreement on that.
Okay, thanks for that. To move on to something else, you mentioned this external tax stakeholder group. I mean, I think some of us feel that we've talked about tax quite a lot, and obviously, I fully agree that we need to engage the public more and why we have tax, and is tax a good thing or a bad thing, and questions like that. But I just wonder, can you explain a little bit more why we need this external tax stakeholder group? And I mean, particularly to take a specific one, council tax, we have been planning to replace for ages and ages, and it still hasn't happened.
So let me take the council tax first. You might be aware, I'm sure you are, of the joint working group between ourselves and COSLA, which is looking at local government taxation generally and broadly. So some progress has already been made around the issue of second homes, empty homes. We'll also have the space to be able to look at, you know, council tax reform, albeit that's going to be a longer term ambition to get that right and get that agreed. So I think that provides a forum for that those discussions to take place. I think it's also against a backdrop of the New Deal for local government. So part of that is the fiscal framework, which is being worked on. Partnership agreement has come first, which sets out the principles, and of course that will be announced soon. The fiscal framework will look at how local government budgets will be taken forward. I think no secret to say what we're talking about there is more flexibility, and also working with local government around revenue raising powers. Obviously the one of the latest is the visitor levy that local government was keen to have, and it's obviously a power they can use or not use, but I think it shows a direction of travel that we want to empower local government both with more flexibility but also with more levers. In terms of the external group, I think it's important that we hear a range of stakeholders. I suspect, and we're going to be sending out the invitations imminently, that the range of views on that external group will be quite broad, from those who wish us to go further in terms of, you know, using tax levers in a progressive way, and those who wish us to be more constrained with the tax levers. So it's important for me, I think, to hear that range of views. Ultimately, government will have to come to a view, and we'll set out our stall in terms of our tax proposition for 2024-25. Taking all of that into account, looking at the pressures on the budget, but also the need for fairness in taxation, and to land in a space that balances all of those competing demands. So happy as soon as we send out the invitations to furnish the committee with the detail of who and the meeting schedule across the summer. It'd be my intention to have a series of meetings across the summer into the lead up to the budget.
Yeah. Okay, well, colleagues may want to come in on that as well, but I've just got one other thing I wanted to touch on. In the medium-term financial strategy, there was mention, I think the quote is, unapologetically direct our resources to those in greatest need, and about effective targeting. Is that a kind of hint that there's going to be more targeted support and benefits for people rather than universal benefits?
So, as I said at the time of the statement, we need to look at our spend through the lens of the core missions that were set out, and to be really, really focused given the financial challenge. That was in terms of poverty, net zero and sustainable public services. So if you take that first core mission, a lot of our policies already are very much focused on tackling poverty, so Scottish Child Payment being a key lever in helping to meet our child poverty targets. We have over 500 programmes running across government, so obviously a lot of programmes, and I don't think it's unreasonable to be putting those programmes through those lenses to look at how far they go in meeting those core missions. Now, in doing so, there's a balance to be struck. So clearly, looking at what would be the objectives of changing any programmes, can we create better outcomes for people who need the support the most, and balancing that with the social contract of, you know, people pay their taxes, and, you know, those who are paid more in Scotland pay a bit more. They need to obviously receive the social contract for that, which is a range of services that they receive that go beyond what they would receive elsewhere in the UK. So in coming to the position, after all that work has been done, and it's ongoing, so there's no conclusions as yet, but it is ongoing, and it will be ongoing over the summer, we want to reach a position in advance of the budget that has that balance, that creates a credible and fair set of propositions. We also, I would like to try to create, and I mentioned in my opening remarks, some headroom to tackle some of the big issues. So if you take our desire to get more people into work and to help people to take more hours on, to get better paid work, childcare is an absolute key lever there. Now, we've made huge progress, and the childcare offer in Scotland is far and way in excess of that offered elsewhere in the UK. But I think we need to go further. But to be able to go further, we need the headroom to be able to expand that childcare offer. So we need to think about that as well as sustaining the services that we have. So again, we will be open and transparent once that work has been done. We'll present our proposition. It's for others to look at that and to either agree or not agree. And if people want to propose alternatives to that, then obviously they need to set out the detail of those proposals too.
Okay, thanks very much. Well, we'll move on now. So Liz Smith's going to go next.
Thank you. Good morning. Cabinet Secretary, first of all, can I welcome the acknowledgement of the serious fiscal situation that the Scottish Government is facing? I think that was good to hear from you. You said in the medium-term financial statement to Parliament that by 2026 that you're going to commit the Scottish economy to what you described as a sustainable trajectory. and that you made no bones about the fact that tough decisions are going to have to be made. Can I just ask about this? Because obviously all the forecasters and Scottish Government statistics are projecting very considerable increases in health spending, in social care spending and in social security spending over the next 5 years. And I think I'm right in saying the social security one alone is something like going up from 5.3 billion to 7.8 billion, I think it is. Now, these are all policies which tie into what you have just spoken about in terms of addressing poverty and addressing those who are most vulnerable. So if that spending is going to be so high, can I ask you where you think you're going to be able to make the tough decisions that will help the fiscal situation?
So in addition to what I've just said, that you know we are going through all of our programmes through that lens of those core missions. So over 500 programmes, we will look at how each of those programmes will help us to meet those core missions. In addition, you're quite right to point towards the increase in social security spend beyond the block grant adjustment. I'm going to make no apologies for that. I think it's the right place to invest money given the cost of living crisis and our need to lift people out of poverty. But of course, we need to be able to afford that. So that will mean some of those difficult decisions being made. I can't obviously give you detail today because that work hasn't completed and I would want to present that in the round in terms of what that looks like. The other pillar, though, is in terms of growing the economy and the tax base. And actually, there are, I think, some causes for optimism there. There was information published, data published this morning that shows, for example, that the HMRC data for May 2023, published alongside the labour market stats, shows 2.44 million people in payrolled employment in Scotland. That's an increase from April and 56,000 more than February 2020, which was obviously pre-pandemic, and 28,000 higher than last May. And I think that is a good barometer for income tax. So I think we are seeing cause for optimism there in terms of some of that feeding through into a more positive tax reconciliation position, which is good. So we need to do all of that. So we need to make sure our spend is focused on where it needs to be. We need to make sure we grow the economy and therefore the tax base. And we need to have a fair and proportionate tax system that, you know, as we've said, our position is we support progressive taxation, where those with the broadest shoulders pay a bit more. And that, of course, has brought in much needed revenue to the economy, to the budget rather. You know, had we not made those changes in Scotland, our public finances would be considerably less. So all of those are have to be looked at in the round.
Thank you for that. I'll come to the tax issue and widening the tax base in just a minute. Can I just go back to this issue about the projected increases in health, social care and social security? And you're saying that you're looking at 500 different programmes as to where potential savings might be made. Does that include the National Care Service?
So the National Care Service, as the committee is aware, is being the programme and the parliamentary timetable was paused in order to create some space over the summer to look at trying to reach a more consensual position, not least with local government. And that meant that the financial statement around the National Care Service would also need to be revised. And I think the commitment has been made by the Minister to provide that information in advance of stage one. So clearly that work is ongoing. I mean, the National Care Service, I think, is important in creating, and I've said this before, as a former home care organiser, I could speak for the whole committee session about this, but I won't. But, you know, I've seen it up close and personal where the system doesn't work for people, and that there needs to be more consistency around national standards and ways of delivery that mean that people get the service that they would expect, no matter where they live in Scotland. Now, how we get to that point clearly is part of the discussions that are happening over the course of the summer. But we do need to have reform in that space. In terms of the overall budget, health and social care, like systems everywhere, certainly in the UK and across Europe and beyond, the growth in health and social care, of course, has been driven mainly by demographics, an ageing population, and we need to provide for that. So in terms of the growth of workforce, that continues to grow. But we do need, as I think we've probably had many discussions about in Parliament, we do need to try to avoid hospital admission. We need to change some of the systems that can help sustain people in a way that is not about everybody, you know, ending up into the acute system. So reform is a really important part of that, as well as ensuring that the spend can deliver what needs to be delivered.
Thank you. I mean, I think the committee's interested on two fronts. Firstly, as you know, we have issues about the financial memorandum and the initial financial memorandum that we had. You know, the lower estimate was £1.3 billion. And obviously, that is a very considerable amount of money in relation to some of the things that we're discussing. So the reason I'm asking the question is to whether the Scottish Government would consider realigning some of that money to help with the other expenditure, given that, you know, we've got so many stakeholders in this Parliament who came to give evidence at committees, and we've also got, you know, four committee reports where the particular National Care Service programme that the Scottish Government has put forward is obviously not desperately popular. And I'm just asking for confirmation that that's something that is going to be reviewed.
It depends, though, who you speak to. If you speak to stakeholders who are in recipients of care, they're really keen to see progress on things like national consistency, standards, and all of those improvements. Where there are challenges is around, well, local government's view is they obviously don't want to lose that local control over the service they provide. I think we can find a way forward through all of that, and then I guess the money will relate to what that looks like and what the time frame for delivery of that is. So, you know, we have to get that bit right before the money comes into play. And, you know, I suspect there will need to be a new financial memorandum, and that will, of course, be definitely be there for all to see in advance of stage one.
They have to be a new financial memorandum, and I would reflect again that, you know, four committees of this Parliament are not happy with the current plan, so that's the reason I was asking the question. Can I just turn to the tax issue? You've obviously made no apology for a progressive tax agenda, but is it not the case, Cabinet Secretary, that the current structures are not yielding the increase in revenues that we need? You know, I think in 2021 budget, the revenues were only 96 million more than the amount that was subtracted from the block grant. That was Institute of Fiscal Studies, and I think the Scottish Government came out with the same statistic. What do you propose doing to ensure that the tax base is not only wider than it is just now, but that the revenues that we get from tax overall are going to increase? Because that is a major part of the equation that you described in your opening statement.
So, so first of all, I was pretty explicit about the need to grow the economy and making that link very directly into fiscal policy and the need for the tax base to expand and grow. And, of course, the NSET sets out the economic plan. And we need to look at issues like childcare that I mentioned earlier on in terms of how do we help those who are either not in work at the moment or are in low-paid work or in hours that are not, you know, sustaining their household budget. And childcare is one of the key elements of that. So we'll continue to make progress. And I think there are signs that are positive in terms of GDP. Also, I don't know if you saw the SDI figures of inward investment. So there's there's a strong base there to work from. But of course, we need to make sure that that translates into our tax revenues. I mean, the latest forecast of the net position for income tax in 2023-24, it has also improved, rising from the 325 million at the time of the Scottish budget to 411 million in the latest forecast. And whilst that doesn't have any impact on spending power, it is encouraging as you know, developing our strategy to ensure the fiscal sustainability of the Scottish budget. So we need to do more. Clearly, the fiscal framework is relevant here in terms of how that works, in terms of how all of the moving parts of the framework deliver you know, what essentially we then have to spend within our budget. And having more levers at our control, and I've set out all of the reasons earlier on why that's important, will be able to help us to smooth some of the peaks and troughs that inevitably happen around all of those moving parts when they land in terms of the money available for us to spend. So I think the encouraging signs that income tax performance is improving. We shouldn't be complacent about that. And we certainly want to make sure that we continue to see that growth so that there's a net positive benefit for the Scottish budget.
Cabinet Secretary, notwithstanding that, it is not the case that the overall tax revenues are nothing like what we need to be able to take in to address some of the funding gap. That's the problem. And today's statistics about unemployment, employment and economic inactivity were pretty stark about the numbers of people who are not actually in work at all. And of course, that means a loss of potential revenue. And then we've got the issue with North East jobs, which are some of the better paid, with people paying slightly higher tax rates. That money is not coming into the Scottish Government. So it's a pretty serious situation where the tax revenue that the Scottish Government is getting just now is nothing like what is required to deliver extra money for the Scottish Government for its public expenditure.
So let me say, first of all, we can't, the gap that you talked about can't all be closed by taxation. And I've not said that. And what I'm saying is that our spending plans in terms of the focusing and the targeting on the key, the core missions that I mentioned earlier on, that all of those pillars are important. Tax is one, but it's not at all. Having the powers to raise more money, clearly, is important as well. But if you look at the SFC forecast around nominal earnings in Scotland, they're talking about that going through a period of higher growth relative to the growth in earnings forecast by the OBR for the rest of the UK over the next 5 years, supporting our tax base. So it can't be the only answer, but it is an important part of the equation, and it is looking more positive aside from what we choose to do in terms of the tax policy. The revenues are looking more positive, and that's got to be something hopefully that is welcomed. In terms of the figures this morning, I mean, unemployment is still below that of the UK. Employment is slightly fallen, but still in a good place. And economic inactivity, you're right, and that's why, of course, the action we're taking around supporting people into work, even though, you know, there are, well, and bearing in mind there are acute labour shortages in many sectors, we need to join the dots there of supporting people into work and making sure that whether it's training or whether it's support and skills support, that we, or childcare, that we help people into work and into more better paid work and additional hours if that's what they're seeking.
Okay. One very final question, Cabinet Secretary. What would you do to make Scotland more competitive in terms of tax in comparison to the rest of the UK?
Well, in terms of the rest of the UK, we, of course, have the lowest poundage. That was the number one ask of business, and that is what was delivered in terms of of the poundage, and we are discussing with business around the issue of non-domestic rates going forward. Tom Arthur, Minister responsible, has a working group where business is represented around the table to look at the future going forward. We want to, I think, make sure that Scotland is seen as a good place to come and invest. And if you look at those SDI figures over the last period, supporting 86 employment opportunities here in Scotland in terms of new business and sustained business, which I think delivered about 8,500 new jobs or sustained jobs that are down to those inward investment decisions that companies have made. They could have gone anywhere, but they've decided to come to Scotland. And that has got to be, I think, a sign of their confidence in coming to locate here in Scotland. And I'm sure that's something we would all welcome.
Right, thanks very much. And we'll move on to the next question, which is from Michelle Thompson.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for joining us today. One of the things that was discussed with the Scottish Fiscal Commission last week was the 14% cut for capital expenditure from 2023-2024 to 2028-2029. And I had asked the SFC for clarification what the implications of that could be in limiting our ability to invest, particularly traditionally, you know, economists should say that you invest when your economy is not doing so well. Now, the clear point emerged was that it does have a direct impact on productivity. Now, we know there's a massive issue with productivity in the UK, and because of these limitations, there is an issue with productivity in Scotland. I wanted to ask whether you had been able to do any modelling of that diminution of productivity, because it doesn't seem to be understood that lower productivity leads to a lower tax take, and that lower tax take then leads to less money being available to spend for public services. So I don't know if you've, behind the scenes, and it may well be some of your officials, whether you're able to model that, because I suppose the point I'm making, this 14% cut in real terms will have a direct flow through to the tax take available to spend on vital public services.
Yeah. Let me just start with the capital funding point. And you're right. I mean, it is extremely challenging capital outlook, and at a time where we want to be investing in the infrastructure. So it's the worst time for capital budgets to be cut. And I can just remind the committee that, it's our capital funding expected to reduced by 7% in real terms between 2023-24 and 2027-28. And of course, Barnett funding is by far the largest element of the Scottish Government's capital funding envelope. So it is, you know, essentially dictated by those decisions. So hugely challenging indeed. And, you know, as the MTFS explains, the challenges in capital funding outlook mean it may be necessary to, you know, prioritise borrowing capacity in the coming years, potentially at the expense of longer term capacity. So we have some difficult decisions to make about how we manage our way through that. And of course, we'll have to set all of that out. We'll do so. In terms of the wider point about productivity, we have now appointed a chief economist, Gregor Irwin, who actually did an excellent presentation to a pre-cabinet discussion around many of these issues, around, you know, the prospect in terms of GDP, earnings growth, but productivity is an important part of that, and increasing productivity is clearly a key part. The NSET has clearly recognised that as well in terms of what needs to be done. So all of that is critical. In terms of how we go forward, we publish progress updates on the delivery of capital investments twice a year, and these updates cover all the infrastructure projects over 5 million and all the programmes over 20 million. I think there's one due soon. And, you know, I think those will show that the importance and the variation of those infrastructure investments. We will come back to Parliament setting out how we're going to manage through that constrained capital funding going forward, and you know, I'm sure the committee will take a close interest in the detail of that.
Yeah. I mean, you lead me on to another wider point, which is the difficulty for ordinary members of the public to understand the complexity of the fiscal framework and what the implications are. So talking about tax take, I appreciate that for most members of the public, it's really hard for them to understand that there is a direct impact by having limitations on borrowing powers for the Scottish Government to pay for CapEx projects. But perhaps a kind of wider area is that people understand that limits on immigration mean less people paying tax. I suppose, are you considering how we make it clear to people that, yes, I agree we have an issue with our breadth of tax base. I think everybody agrees with that. But there are standard levers that you might want to pull to increase them. So as part of your discussions with the UK government, can you see, although it was probably not mentioned in the report, that a differentiated immigration policy fundamentally to increase the tax base should be part of those discussions?
So let me say, first of all, that you're absolutely right about the constraints on migration. I saw that there was quite a lot of commentary from the business community this morning around the challenges that they're having in recruiting to large sectors of the tourism industry. And they are very clear that it's down to not being able to access labour that they previously accessed through the European Union. And they're, you know, very explicit about that. We are trying to do what we can, and we've got the new talent migration scheme that we are going to launch soon, in attempting to encourage people to come and live and work in Scotland. And I think there are, you know, as I said earlier on, plenty of opportunities for people to do that, and we want to promote that. In terms of how much these issues can be brought into the discussions around the fiscal framework, you'll appreciate a lot of those discussions will be quite technical. So they're technical around the issues of borrowing powers, the limits, the reserve, rather than necessarily around the wider policy issues that form part of the backdrop to all of this. It doesn't mean they're not important, and we raise them with the UK government all the time, but the actual negotiation around the framework will be around the technicalities of what the framework is at the moment and where we see the key things that need to change and be adjusted that will make a difference to the ability of us to be able to smooth out some of the things like the negative tax reconciliation. That it won't be the job done, though. You know, getting some adjustments to the framework is just part of a process. You know, we want to have those additional levers, including over migration and you know. So those discussions will and those calls and those asks will, of course, continue beyond the detail of the framework.
OK, just my last area then. You'll be aware that this committee's looking at kind of public sector review and spend and so on, in the light of the kind of rolling back from the resource spending review. And obviously, I note your kind of three key missions, of which part of that you're going to be looking at public bodies and public sector reform yourself. I suppose my question is, to what extent are you open-minded to really thinking quite ambitiously about that? Because part of my private worry is that agencies themselves may simply look at efficiencies, although I suspect a lot of them have been doing that for a period of years due to public sector constraints. But we had a very interesting kind of comment that perhaps the government being able to mandate bolder, more ambitious projects would really need to come from government. So I suppose my simple question to you is that are you going to be able to have a level of ambition in what you look at, although I appreciate projects such as that have a cost in themselves and are very complex and time-consuming. I'm not negating that, but it's just to get a sense of, is it more than efficiencies, in other words?
It needs to be more than efficiencies. Efficiencies are the kind of de minimis position. So 129 public bodies all, you know, doing a good job, but all with the states, all with backroom offices, all some doing some similar things. So, you know, as a minimum, you know, efficiency, digitisation. So you look at the work of the National Records for Scotland, they have transformed their organisation. Scottish Water is also an organisation that has become very agile and able to respond and you know, drive out efficiencies, but delivering a really good service. So there are examples that I think the rest of the public sector could learn from, and we are requiring them to learn from. So what the programme of work that we've set out, and I've got the responsibility to drive forward the overall picture of what this looks like. I've had bilaterals with all my colleagues to make sure that we've got clarity around the short-term objectives, so efficiencies clearly, but the medium to longer term, what are the opportunities? People were working in different ways now. So what's the opportunity to look at the estates that are quite vast in terms of across the public sector? And also, you know, are there opportunities for mergers, for shared services? What I want to avoid, though, is that people become consumed with structural change rather than the objective of improving services and better outcomes. So we need to just avoid, we tip into who's going to get what job, territory, and not onto what are the better outcomes that we need from our public services. So I see this as a very important area of work. We need to make sure if we're creating new public bodies that we've thought through whether or not that's the right way to go, rather than it being the first go-to, you know, which maybe we're all guilty of previously. You know, so that landscape needs to be absolutely agile. It needs to be working to, you know, best effect, delivering good outcomes for the public. And I'm, as I say, driving that forward. Happy to keep the committee updated of some of the detail and to point to where there's really examples of good practice and good outcomes.
Okay. Thank you, Convener. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Michelle. And on to Keith Brown next.
Thanks. Good morning. Some of the questions I was going to ask are ones that Michelle Thompson's asked and others, but just to revisit, first of all, the fiscal framework. From what you're saying, Deputy First Minister, it seems to be that the negotiations, which I know you can't go into detail about, seem to be in the undergrowth of the discussions and the detail of the discussions. I just wonder if the more fundamental issues, my own views of fiscal framework has failed over time. But what Michelle Thompson said about the impenetrability of this, people cannot possibly understand. It's a bit like the UK tax code. It's so complex. Mm-hmm. That can't be good for transparency and accountability. Is that being looked at? And secondly, the very basis of it, whereby expenditure in England is decided and then literally, consequentially, Scotland gets a share of that, seems to me to be totally counterintuitive to what devolution was meant to be about, which is to recognise the differences in different parts of the UK. So I just wonder if those more fundamental issues are being examined, or is it the case it's really about how it's working and the detail of it alone?
So let me agree, first of all, on the kind of premise. I mean, we have to deliver against one rule set by the UK government, that is to balance the annual budget. That's our requirement. And we have to deliver this fiscal rule with those limited fiscal levers at our disposal, with no ability to borrow for the day-to-day spending that, you know, other governments would, and almost two-thirds of funding tied to UK government spending plans. That is the backdrop to the challenges that we have. Now, I guess I would answer that in two parts. So the first, in terms of the review in the immediate, is to secure some immediate improvements. And I guess if you're looking at on a scale of 1 to 10 of a major, you know, complete rewriting of the fiscal framework being 10 and, you know, no change being 1, you know, we're somewhere in the middle of, wanting some significant adjustments to the framework to help us manage some of that difficulty. But we're not going to get to a full complete rewriting of the framework at 10. That's just not the territory we're in. So we need to take what we can get in terms of getting an improvement to our position, and that's what we will do. There's then the wider question about, well, what's the future? And I think we absolutely need to get into a space of looking at the fiscal powers more generally, and obviously we've got a very clear ambition for what that looks like, but there are also opportunities under devolution to have far greater fiscal power. I mean, if you look at local authorities, have more fiscal powers in terms of borrowing than the Scottish Government has. That can't be right. The Welsh Government are similarly minded that we need to get back, I think, to some of the fundamentals here. Now, that there may be opportunities in the future to negotiate something far more ambitious, and that can change some of those fundamental restrictions and inherent links to every UK government funding decision and spending decision that we, you know, take the consequence from, which are not always positive and quite often are not positive. That isn't going to be achieved, though, through what is quite a technical review of the framework in the here and now. But my ambition is that we need to go far, you know, much further than that in terms of how the current system operates.
I think that's, in some senses, disappointing, but I'd hope even within the constraints of that technical-led review, that it used to be said that grant-aided expenditure formula for local authorities in Scotland was understood by two people. I think it's half that understand the fiscal framework. It'd be good to see that expanded, if possible. On the general area of tax and resources, and you mentioned a generally improving tax position, and just to say that there's research published last night showing that been a 79% increase in council tax in England, whereas in Scotland we're about £300 or £400 on average less than that. So it is a pretty competitive position across the tax take. However, have you done any analysis on the impact of generally higher public sector wages in Scotland driving that increase in revenues and generally lower unemployment, certainly over the last year or so in Scotland? Is that responsible for, and I realise that some of that is quite recent, although again evidence just published shows that I think the increase in Scotland in wage growth was about 8.4% as opposed to 7.1% in England and Wales. Is that what is, do you think, is driving the increased tax take?
I'll bring officials in a second. I think so it's absolutely right that we have a larger public sector in Scotland and it is better paid. So inevitably, you know, that will have an impact in terms of the importance of the public sector for the tax base. It also, though, has a challenge because of public sector pay deals. You've got a larger public sector, the pay deals are going to have more of an impact, and of course we've tried to avoid strikes, so we have, quite rightly obviously, so we have landed pay deals, you know, that are above what was budgeted for, and that is one of the factors pointed to by the SFC in terms of one of the challenges. But nevertheless, it is an important element in terms of, you know, our economy, and of course important in terms of delivering public services. I don't know if there's anything that officials want to add, Andrew.
Well, very briefly, I think when the Fiscal Commission were here last week, they did talk about some of the modelling they'd done on that. But the overwhelming situation is that three quarters of the tax take comes from the private sector. So what's happening there is much more significant. And what the Fiscal Commission has done overall is very marginally uprate its wage growth assumptions for the next year, and that in part explains why the tax take is higher.
Yeah, thanks for that, although there's obviously a relationship between private sector wage growth and public sector wage growth in any economy. My last question, again, it's going back to the point that Michelle Thompson raised, and it's back to this idea that we're going to see a cut in capital budgets by 14% by 2020. And again, Michelle Thompson's point that most economists would agree, and I've been a critic of the £2.5 trillion of debt the UK government's accumulated, but most economists agree that debt that is incurred as part of capital expenditure is beneficial for an economy. And that being the case, and you may have answered this in relation to Michelle Thompson's point, is there a particular argument being put to the UK government on this, that the capital constraints that are there just now are not serving certainly Scotland or even the UK? Is there particular representations? I know beyond the general point about how damaging having austerity budget is, but on the capital side, is there any sign that the UK government will be willing to move on that?
So, I mean, we've raised that obviously as a key concern around the budgets and the fiscal outlook in terms of capital. And we've made all of those points that in terms of COVID recovery and recovery from the cost of living crisis, investment in infrastructure is important and key. And for that to be reducing is the wrong decision. So we've made all of those representations. We've made that point very robustly. Is that position going to change? I mean, the outlook is the outlook. As things stand at the moment, there is no sign of that changing. But obviously, the autumn statement, we will watch very carefully to see if there's any recognition that actually reducing capital budgets at this time is not the right policy and not the right direction of travel. But I can only tell you what is in front of us at the moment, and that's that very difficult outlook on capital.
A very brief last point just related to that. It was, as I'm sure you remember, in the 2010 to 2018 period, not unusual for the UK government to announce, you know, sudden expansions of capital finance. We used to have to find shovel-ready projects, as it was called, but that seems to have just fallen away. You don't expect any movement in relation to that?
We're not aware of anything, but you know, we sometimes find out very late in the day. We don't get an awful lot of information in advance of the autumn statement, for example. So we don't know, but clearly we would utilise any capital availability, and we had benefited from an increase at one point on financial transactions, which we had utilised for the affordable housing programme, and that was the main use that we put FTs to. But again, even that has has dropped off and is looking like it will continue to decline. So we will continue to make those representations because it is a key point in terms of that recovery.
Thanks. Yeah, thank you. And next up is Ross Greer.
Thanks, Convener. Just a factual question in the first instance, Cabinet Secretary, you might not have the answer to hand, but given that a number of public sector pay negotiations were only concluded after Parliament had passed the budget, do you know what the total public sector pay bill in Scotland now is for 23-24?
So we know that it was £900 million above what the budget had programmed for. In terms of the entire pay bill, I had something in my mind of around 24 billion, 24 point something billion. I can come back with the exact figure, but it is a large chunk of the budget. Clearly most of the money, it's over 24 billion, it goes on pay. And I guess that's the point I was making to Keith Brown, that because the pay deals to try and avoid strike action, etc., we have, and because of inflation costs and people's household budgets really suffering for that, we wanted to try to reach as fair settlements as possible, but with pay being the main expenditure in the accounts, any addition to the pay bill is going to be considerable, and these things need to be balanced.
Thanks very much. The committee had a roundtable a couple of weeks ago with various representatives of public sector organisations, and one of the points that came up during the course of that discussion was that a number of the bodies represented around the table had expressed an interest in the Scottish Government's potential pilot of the four-day week. Mm-hmm. Now, I'd say this with the significant caveat that this is by no means the universal position of trade unions representing workers in the public sector, but a number of public sector workers in Scotland, a number of local union reps within various public agencies have expressed an interest to me in that, partly in recognition of the fact that they know in pay rises in line with inflation across the board in the public sector are not affordable right now. So they are, whilst they're interested in maximising the pay offer made to their members, obviously, they're expressing an increasingly significant interest in these other changes to terms and conditions that might be beneficial to workers. Do you have any update on the progress with the four-day working week pilot?
So I'll ask officials come in on the pilot itself, but I think it's fair to say that in any pay negotiation, it's quite often not just about pay. So other elements will be brought in around terms and conditions. And the four-day week is, I think, something that has become far more of a live issue, not least that the way people's ways of working has changed. So many more people working from home. And I guess for me, going back to Michelle Thompson's point about productivity, there's something about, and quite a lot of, it's not just public sector, some private businesses are looking at this as well, that essentially is, look, if you can improve your productivity, maintain or improve your productivity, and you can do that over 4 days rather than five, then why not give that flexibility to staff. So it is something that I think is very current, that a lot of employers are looking at. And in the public sector, we have the pilot. Alison, do you want to give a bit of an update?
Yes. Yeah, thank you. The plans for the pilot are being developed. We're in discussion with a small number of public bodies who have expressed an interest in taking part in that pilot. And we have a very modest budget set aside for this financial year to support them in doing that, particularly to generate the evaluation and the evidence of the impact of the four-day working week. Obviously, there are different ways in which a four-day working week can be operationalised, and a number of those can also come at a cost to the public finances if it's about reducing the number of hours we worked in a week if we don't see those productivity gains alongside it. So all these factors will be taken into account in terms of the pilot, and I would expect that we'll be able to give an update to the committee if it's something you're interested in the next couple of months.
That'd be fantastic. Thanks. So just to clarify, the intention then is for the pilot to operate at some point in the current financial year, or to at least start in the current financial year.
Yes, that's our intention.
Grand. And Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned the 500-ish initiatives and programmes that the Scottish Government has. On that point, I'm interested in how we ensure best value for money and policy coherence across all of those, particularly in relation to the overarching missions around reducing poverty, net zero. So, for example, there's something in the region of £750 million of expenditure each year in NDR relief, or £750 million that's not taken in NDR income. And some of that very clearly aligns with government's overall objectives. So the renewable relief, for example, obviously contributes to the net zero objective, but it's a small one. What instructions are being given to your cabinet colleagues and to SG directorates to ensure that they are getting best value for money out of every initiative they're responsible for that might not necessarily on the face of it have an obvious connection to one of the overarching objectives, but which could contribute towards it? So, for example, in other areas of NDR relief that are not necessarily about lifting people out of poverty, you could apply a condition that the company can only get that relief if it is signed up to pay at least a real living wage, just as a speculative example. How are we ensuring that policy coherence and best value for money across the board?
So, as I said earlier on, the lens that each programme will be put through is, you know, around those core missions. Do they reduce poverty? Do they help to grow the economy in a sustainable way, in net zero, you know, sustaining public finances? And then, of course, there'll inevitably be a bit of political oversight on some of that as well. So we will work through all of that. I mean, in terms of, you know, business taxes, you mentioned NDR, in the subgroup that I mentioned earlier on that is looking at NDR, which Tom Arthur is chairing, I guess is an opportunity to look at whether the supports are the right supports, and are there supports that need to be more focused? What does, you know, the business community itself feel and want in terms of the priorities? Now, you know, not everything can be a priority, and not everything can be agreed. So we need to get a sense of, you know, what are the key priorities and what delivers in terms of sustaining small businesses, bedrock of the Scottish economy, and our key sectors. So all of that will be worked through. I mean, as I said earlier on, you know, one of the key asks from business has been around maintaining the lowest poundage in the UK, and that has been a key ask of business and has been an important support for business. So we need to, at the end of this process, reach a position that is balanced, that delivers on all those key objectives, and is affordable. So, you know, there will be some quite challenging decisions. We can't, you know, there are many asks of government from every part of every stakeholder, every part of society, and we need to land that in a space that is fair, that is consistent, and achieves the objectives that was set out.
Thanks very much. I'm still interested, though, in how we achieve that, the policy coherence aspect mm-hmm. of that. So, is each cabinet secretary essentially responsible for ensuring that the books balance in their portfolio in their own way, or is there, on the basis of the First Minister's prospectus from April, are there a set of instructions being issued? So, for example, In education, I can't remember off the top of my head whether there are conditions attached to the pupil equity fund. Now, a lot of pupil equity funding is used by schools to pay for third and private sector organisations and has clear additional benefit, but I don't know if we attach, for example, a real living wage condition to use of the pupil equity fund, which would obviously align with the poverty objective. Is that overarching set of objectives being used to give instruction to each directorate, each cabinet secretary, to ensure that we're achieving that kind of policy coherence and value for money?
Yeah, so the leadership role sits with each cabinet secretary within their area to look at all of the programmes within their area to make sure, or to check against those core missions and whether or not, how far those programmes go in delivering those objectives. And then we will look collectively at all of that in terms of, well, what does that picture tell us? And what decisions do we, you know, should we make in the light of the challenging financial outlook and the need to reduce poverty, to, you know, make sure we deliver on net zero, to make sure that we have sustainable public services and that our economy is as vibrant as it can be. So, you know, we need to work through all of that, and the, you know, the initial phase is the leadership role that each cabinet secretary will need to apply to that.
Thanks very much. That's all from me, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Douglas Lumsden's next.
Oh, thank you, Convener. Got me by surprise there. Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned earlier in questioning from Liz Smith about the employment rate. You said it went down slightly. From what I'm seeing, it went down by 1.8%. And I don't think that's a slight drop. I think that's quite a huge drop in relative terms. So what sort of impact will that have on the tax net position flowing through? Because obviously it looks like it's going to be positive going forward, the net position. But when we have a drop like that, what sort of changes can that have to that position?
Well, clearly the employment rate going down is not what we would have wanted to see. But a couple of points. First of all, the employment rate has, you know, is still, you know, in a good position, and you know the labour market information tells us that essentially, you know, there are big sectors within the economy that are struggling to recruit. So employment levels are still very high, and you know the economy, I think, is in a place that is an improving one. Unemployment is lower than the UK as a whole. And the figure I gave you earlier on, I think it was in response to Liz Smith, around the barometer for income tax, was showing that the HMRC data, which is the actual data in terms of labour market statistics in terms of payrolled employment in Scotland, which is important because these are people that are paying tax, you know, has increased from April, and there's 56,000 more than pre-pandemic February 2020 and 28,000 higher than last May. And that, as I said earlier, is a good barometer for income tax because that will be more people paying more tax. So I'm not complacent at all. We shouldn't be around the ONS figures, and we need to see what the trend is in terms of what the next set of statistics show. But you know, we have an economy that is, you know, the GDP is growing faster than the UK's, unemployment is lower, and earnings in Scotland are growing faster than the UK, and the SFC forecasts show this to be continuing. So all of that, I think, shows cause for optimism. But you know, we of course shouldn't be complacent about the employment figure. I should just also say the point made earlier on, the figure that we should be more focused on, I guess, is the issue of economic inactivity. We need to get that down. We need to get more people into work, and that's why, you know, the work that's going on around making sure that people who need that extra support to get into work are given that support. So that's probably the figure If you were to ask me what concerns me most, it would be the economic inactivity.
So how are you going to address that economic inactivity?
So clearly NSET has set out how we are going to grow the economy in terms of those key areas of growth. We also need to focus on things like employability and skills. So the Withers Review, I think, is showing a way forward in terms of a much more coherent offer to people in terms of skills development, upskilling. We have some huge areas of growth that are coming in the green economy. We need to make sure that those opportunities reach everybody and that they're open to everybody. So we've got a lot of work to do around employability. There's some really good programmes where people who perhaps are in, you know, pretty low-paid jobs. So we're not talking here just about people who are not working, but there are people who are in, you know, insecure employment who are being supported into more secure, better-paid employment, and that is also an important part of what we need to do. Mm-hmm. So not one easy answer here, but I think all of those are...
Yeah, and Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned the OBR figures and the SFC figures. Obviously, they are diverging quite a lot. 2% is the OBR's forecast for earnings growth, and it's 2.6% for SFC. But they do say that that should be interpreted with caution, as it's sensitive to changes in the forecasts. How much confidence do you have that the Scottish economy, or sort of earnings growth, is going to outperform the rest of the UK? Because as we all know, that's key when it comes to the fiscal framework, that we have to be outperforming the rest of the UK to see the positive block grant adjustments.
So in 2022, the Scottish economy grew by 4.9% compared to 4.1% in the UK. And the latest ONS data show that earnings, so it's not just SFC, it show that earnings are growing faster in Scotland than any other part of the UK. I think Scotland was 9% median earnings annual growth to April. Scotland was 9%. The next highest was 8%. Scottish earnings are forecast to grow faster than the UK. The SFC, as you mentioned, forecast that average earnings will grow by 4.6% this year compared to 4.1% forecast for the UK by the OBR. The SFC, I think, they'll have done a lot of detailed analysis around the Scottish economy itself, and you know, I think we should have confidence in their forecasts. I think also, just on this final point, if you look at the tax data, and the reason I keep coming back to this is, I guess, it's hard evidence. It's what we know. So the provisional in-year PAYE tax data for the first 11 months of 2022-23 suggests that growth in Scottish PAYE income tax receipts has outperformed the rest of the UK. So that's not a forecast, it's an actual, here is the evidence. So we've not been complacent here, we've got to keep an eye on it. But all I'm saying is, cause for some optimism there, yeah, I would say.
Optimism, but they also say it should be interpreted with caution.
Of course, but I guess any forecasts always have an element of risk and caution. But when you look at that HMRC data, it does show a trend that is actual in the here and now evidence that would hopefully give us some cause for optimism. The forecasts will show that trend continuing, but of course we can't be complacent.
Moving on to public sector reform, I think you mentioned you're working on an overall picture of probably what the public sector landscape will look like.
Yeah.
When do we expect to see that? Because I'd imagine that's going to be key for setting the budgets in years to come.
Oh, so we're not starting from scratch here. You will have heard my predecessor, John Swinney, talk a lot about public service reform, and we have been working over quite some time to get the public sector, public bodies thinking in a more sharply focused way about efficiency, about their how they work with each other, what their future plans are that can deliver better outcomes in a more efficient way. So there's a 10-year programme of public bodies and public service reform that really seeks to do all of that. My job, I guess, is to bring a pace and acceleration to some of that work across government, and to have that radar of beyond the individual bits of, well, what does that look like as a collective picture in terms of the public sector, and how can we make sure we don't just do the minimum in that space, but that we're getting every public body maximising what they're doing in the most efficient way to the best performing. So I mentioned NRS, mentioned Scottish Water. How do we link up the best performing and what they've done and make sure that happens everywhere?
But would you mentioned public bodies working better together. Do you think that is going to be something they will voluntarily do, or do you think that's got to be mandated? Because the evidence we've heard is that you only get proper big reform when it's mandated centrally.
So if you look at NRS and Scottish Water, they were set the same challenge as other public bodies to make sure that they can live within their budgets, which are under strain, and therefore they need to drive their own efficiencies and consume their own smoke, if you like. They also, though, need to improve outcomes. So that's quite a challenge. Scottish Water have carried out a huge programme of efficiency and reform. NRS similarly focused very much on digital opportunities. Now, they weren't forced to do that, but they have had the leadership within their organisations that recognise the need to do that. And I guess what we need to make sure is that the pace isn't at the pace of the slowest, it's actually at that pace. Mm-hmm. So there's an organisation that brings together the leadership of all of the public bodies, and there's work going on there to share that best practice around, well, how did they do it, what did they do, how can we do? I think public bodies know that there's no option than to, given the financial outlook, than to make sure that they are getting on with the reform that they need to do. And it might look a bit different in each organisation, but some of the principles are the same, and we need to see that pace. Now, ultimately, you know, ministers will have a responsibility of oversight to make sure that that pace happens. And, you know, I've been in my bilaterals with my colleagues. We've been talking about, you know, the need for pace around this. So, you know, ministers are aware of the need for them to ensure that we see every organisation get to the point of being the most efficient, the most productive, the best in terms of best outcomes for the people they serve.
But, Cabinet Secretary, all the examples you've gave there are bodies becoming more efficient in themselves, working better, still within their, I'm going to say silo, maybe that's not the best word to use, but it's actually how we get bodies working better together across the board. I'm talking about local authorities working better with the health boards, working with the IJBs. Is that going to be something that has to be mandated going forward?
So silos, they absolutely need to get out their silos, but I think they recognise that. So if you look at the opportunity for shared services, for example, that is being actively looked at and should be actively looked at. There may be opportunities for organisations to go further than that in terms of mergers. Now, local authorities are in a bit of a different position because they are independent organisations. However, many of them are looking at, you know, the potential to work more closely with their neighbouring authorities around shared services. There's also discussions around, you know, where there are quite discrete specialist roles. Is that something that local government can share rather than each trying to recruit from a small pool of specialist people. I think there is an appetite, given you know, the opportunities through the New Deal, for things to be done differently. So there is active discussion in Orkney and the Western Isles around a single island authority. Now, that's something they have raised previously. They are keen and, I guess, champing at the bit, might be the description, to get on. And the driver for that being, you know, you're, again, trying to recruit people to all, particularly in leadership positions, to all these different organisations, fishing in the same small pond. And actually, they've come to us to say, we need to do things differently, and we want to encourage that. Now, there are some issues to be overcome, not least the point you made about the relationship between the local authority and the health board and the lines of accountability there. But these issues are not insurmountable. Where there's a will, there's a way. And I think we want to be very encouraging and permissive to say, whether it's local government or any other part of the public sector, to be generating ideas for reform rather than, it's always been done this way. So the Single Island Authority, I think, could actually end up being a bit of a trailblazer for how things might be done differently elsewhere. So, you know, that's maybe one to look at.
Do you think they'll do that voluntarily, or do you think that has to be mandated? That's the key thing I'm trying to.
Well, the Single Island Authority is that it actually come from the local authority and public sector bodies within the islands themselves. They've come to us to say, we would like to go ahead to scope out how this could be done in a different way, but we need you to be on board. And we've said we're on board, and we need to work through the detail clearly, but we absolutely want that innovation and fresh thinking and reform, and I think that will be a really interesting one to watch.
Is that me out of time? Okay.
Yes, you are out of time. If we've got a little time at the end, I might let you back in, but it's Michael Mara's turn now.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks, Cabinet Secretary, for all the information so far. On the 16th of May, we took evidence from the Permanent Secretary regarding a range of issues in the operation of the civil service. And one of the issues that the committee was interested in was the status of the resource spending review and the objective of returning the public sector workforce to the size pre-COVID. And he talked a little bit about the progress in that area, but he said, and I quote, we asked about the status of that policy within government. He said, I do not think that that has been publicly stated by the new government. I just wondered whether you could give us clarity as whether that approach remains the policy of the SNP government.
So you're right to point out that was the position. The Scottish budget for 23-24, it set out that it's for individual public bodies to ensure that workforce plans and projections are affordable in 2023-24 and in the medium term. And, you know, we are looking really for public bodies to ensure that the workforce numbers and model is within their financial envelope. So essentially, I guess it boils down to having the policy. If you were to take a policy across the whole public sector of returning to pre-COVID levels, that's a bit of a blunt tool. And I think in recognition that some areas of the public sector will, by necessity, have to continue to grow. Health, for one. Social Security, when it's delivering its programmes. The policy needs to be more nuanced than that. So essentially, what we have said is that that public bodies need to have their workforce being the numbers of their workforce need to be affordable within their financial envelope, and that we've set out some workforce scenarios in MTFS with low growth being kind of 0.3 and high being 2.2, and I think that's in recognition that there will be, you know, some parts of the public sector that will continue to grow. So it's a more nuanced approach. But the overall message is that the public sector needs to make sure that its workforce is affordable and that their projections are within their financial envelope.
So the blunt tool, as you put it, of your predecessor, Kate Forbes, has been dropped?
It's become, for each public body will now be responsible for making sure that its workforce is the right size to deliver what needs to be delivered, but is affordable. And that, again, as I said earlier, is in recognition of areas like social security and health, which are areas that are continuing to grow for all the reasons that we understand.
I've taken that as a yes. I think it's important to have the clarity, yeah. Cabinet Secretary, given the lack of clarity, frankly, from the Permanent Secretary, whose department seemed to be pursuing a particular trajectory, but said that he had no clarity on the stated policy of the government. Right. I think it might be useful if we had that stated in clear terms. So am I correct in saying it's a yes?
Yeah, yes.
Okay, but that's fine.
But we don't want to see exponential growth.
Yeah.
Because bodies have to live within their financial means. But, you know, we have to recognise social security, health, etc. If you want, I'm happy to write back to the committee with that set out in writing, if that would be helpful.
I think that would be useful. Useful for the Permanent Secretary and the leaders of the different departments as well.
Yeah.
Because part of the commentary, I think, was around recognising that there would be pay growth, given, and you've outlined some of that today, and that we had to understand the affordability across those other areas.
Yeah.
But I suppose on that basis, part of the commentary on the medium-term financial strategy was that there have been areas that were light on costing. So the National Care Service, childcare, mentioned by various colleagues already. So the Institute for Fiscal Studies talked about that gap and said there was little sense of how that gap would be closed. I mean, reading it and listening to you, if I characterise this, it feels a little bit like you're hoping something will come along.
No, not at all. Certainly would not accept that at all. So to be blunt, come the budget 24-25, I need to set out how we're going to deliver all this within a balanced budget. So there's no ifs, no buts. Now, you know, that detail will be there, and we will set out how we're going to close the gap, because we have to. Unlike other governments that can borrow their way through difficult scenarios, we have to balance our budget. That is a fiscal rule that we cannot escape, and we have limited levers to be able to do that. And of course, since 2007, we've had, you know, unqualified accounts from the Auditor General, so we have managed to do that despite the increasing challenges. What you've set out in terms of NCS and childcare are areas that we need to create some headroom for. So I talked about childcare earlier on around if we want to increase the very good offer that is already there, if we want to increase that because we see it very clearly linked to growing the economy and growing the tax base, and that is a priority, then we need to create the headroom to do that. Now, it may not be able to be done in 1 year in 24-25. In fact, that's going to be a very challenging year to be able to do anything in great scale. But beyond that, in terms of setting out those kind of multi-year objectives of priority for spend, I will... certainly be setting out the detail for the budget, but also what our spending plans over the next few years will be in terms of the priorities. So childcare is a good one that we need to make sure we set out, what and how we will deliver over the next few years. So, far from hoping something will come along, we need to sort and consume our own smoke and with very limited levers. So nothing could be further from the truth.
That the pledge then that the First Minister made in his election campaign to be First Minister on childcare, that can only be delivered if there's further cuts. Is that right?
Well,
that's what headroom is.
Well, so what I've set out are the three areas for the public finances. First is prioritisation and making sure we're targeting and looking at all of our programmes. You would expect any government to do that. The second is increasing our tax base, so that we keep more of the tax that we raise. And the third, of course, is what that tax policy is. So all of those levers are equally important to make sure that our public finances are sustainable and we can create some of that headroom. Now, looking towards the future, we will need to see what the autumn statement brings in terms of whether there will be any improved position over the next few years in terms of the block grant. We just don't know that, and whether there'll be any the potential for consequentials on things like childcare, of course, will be factored in to all of that.
I think kind of that's kind of my point about something might come along. I mean, so the commentary on this, Institute for Fiscal Studies, Spice, Fraser-Valander, talking about the size of the gap, no indication in terms of the strategy. It doesn't feel very strategic in terms of how the gap might be closed. And then highlighting there might be further consequentials that will allow us to do some of the things we've already committed to doing.
No.
Does that not...
But that's not what I said. What I said was we will create the headroom that we need to be able to take forward our policies. What I don't know, though, is what else will transpire in terms of the block grant going forward, whether there are going to be changes to the outlook, whether there'll be changes to consequentials. All of that is additional that could be factored in, but we can't assume any of that. So what we have to do is to set out what we know and how we will manage the fiscal position going forward with what we know. The only point I'm making is there are some things we don't know that might have a material impact on what we set out. Now, you know, we need to manage that. That could be a positive impact. It could be a negative impact. All I'm saying is it is a material factor in terms of we can set out our plans and say we're going to do A, B, C and D. If we get to the autumn statement and there's something that changes in a negative way, clearly that's going to have an impact on what we would, what we've set out. That was the point I was making.
Okay, thank you. Do you have a date for a meeting with ministers on the fiscal framework from the UK government?
We are meeting ministers in the, over the next few weeks.
Over the next, anything more specific?
Well, imminently.
It's not much more specific.
In case the date changes imminently.
Okay, that's fair. I think it's, obviously it's of significant interest to the committee. I also am picking up a point earlier on about the relative competitiveness of council tax rates, I think mm-hmm. it was talked about. I mean, I think it's something that feels a little bit less commented on. I mean, over the last few years in our home city of Dundee, we've had 180 cuts to teacher numbers. The number of additional support needs teachers have dropped from 165 to 93. There's been a cut for attainment challenge funding, which has resulted in 22 posts being lost, including speech therapists and nurseries and schools. Very significant issues. So, on those issues, there are costs, real costs, to some of the most vulnerable people from that supposedly competitive rate, isn't there?
Well, look, the council tax position in relation to England has been set out previously in terms of the council tax going forward. Obviously, there's been more flexibility on council tax setting. We've moved away from the freeze that was previously in place, and councils have had more flexibility in terms of the council tax rate that they set. I think what is, some of the financial challenges facing local authorities are the financial challenges facing the public sector more broadly. Some of the areas that we've, the policies that we've put in place around things like the attainment challenge funding and PEF funding have been important levers. What I would say about Dundee City Council, they have also put in place quite an extensive package of supporting people through the cost of living crisis. So, for example, the Food Insecurity Network is providing and supporting organisations that are literally putting food on people's tables. So, tough times, local authorities will make tough decisions, but looking to the future, that's one of the reasons we need the new partnership agreement. It's the reason we need the new fiscal framework with local government. And there's, I guess, two aspects to that. One is that local authorities need more flexibility in how they spend their money, and that will mean, you know, moving through a programme of looking at ring fencing. Now, that doesn't mean that, you know, there'll be an overnight, you know, all ring fencing has gone, but it is an acknowledgement that, you know, there are lots of pockets of funding that local government has, all of which they have to report for, and some of which is very constraining, but probably doesn't make a lot of sense. So the partnership agreement will set out the principles of how we're going to work together, and the fiscal framework will set out some of the detail around how that will work. And giving that flexibility will mean that, that local authorities, over an increasing period of time, will have more levers at their disposal. And the second part is having more fiscal levers. And I'm really keen to work with local government around what other fiscal levers they may wish. Now, we've had a few in terms of the second homes, empty properties, the visitor levy, but there may be more that local government want to discuss, and I'm keen to have that discussion with them.
And just, I suppose, the specific about how some of that would work. I mean, you are... That number, a drop in additional support needs teachers in Dundee from 165 to 93, almost halved since between 2010 and 2022. It's the balance there, isn't it? Between, I mean, this is the national conversation on education that reported back just last week said that there's essentially there's a crisis in additional support needs teaching across the country. It's one of the principal concerns of the whole of the education system, from children, parents, families, teachers, the whole gamut of that. How do you then drive through the kind of change that you're talking about in fiscal arrangements and make sure we can address that problem? Because that's a trend that cannot be allowed to continue, surely.
So there's two roads to go down here, isn't there? One of increasing ministerial decision-making over what local government spends its money on, and increasing ring fencing, or you have more fiscal flexibility for local authorities, and then they can make their... they would have more flexibility about whether to spend more money on ASN teachers or other areas that they see as a priority. So we're at a crossroads, and those are the two routes. My view is that giving local government more flexibility around its budget will allow them to set the priorities for their local area. And in ASN, that may well be an area that local government wants to prioritise. But, you know, we can't have it both ways. And quite often in Parliament, you know, we hear calls for local government to have more flexibility over its funding, and then the next for ministers to be held to account for how many ASN teachers or staff are in each local authority. So we have some fundamental principles to agree here, and that is essentially going to be set out through the partnership agreement and the fiscal framework. What I would say, though, in terms of the local government settlement in total, and that's not to diminish the challenges that local authorities face, but, you know, we have to recognise, you know, first of all, that we have actually increased the resources available to local government by over £793 million in 23-24, which was a real terms increase of £376 million, 3%. However, inflation is impacting on local government in the same way as it's impacting on the Scottish Government. Pay deals are impacting on local government in the same way as they're impacting on the Scottish Government. And of course, we included £100 million in the budget to help local authorities with the teacher pay deal. So these are not easy things to wrestle with. There is no easy answer. If there was, it would have been done. So my view is, at that crossroads, giving local authorities more financial flexibility, whether that's how they spend their money or how they raise their money, for me is a better road to go down rather than increasing ring fencing in direction.
That's great.
Okay. Thank you very much. Douglas, were you very keen to come in on something else, just briefly?
Just briefly, thank you, convener. In terms of non-domestic rates, we see it increasing by more than 10% over the next 3 years. Can you give us some narrative around that? Is that because of growth or is it because businesses are going to be charged more?
I will maybe ask my officials to come in here. What I would say is that the work on NDR in terms of its huge importance, of course, to local government funding in terms of it being a core part. So we need to make sure that it continues to bring in much-needed resourcing. We do have a strong package of reliefs worth an estimated £749 million in 23-24. And, of course, that is going to be an important balance to strike around where we go with NDR into the future, which is why that consultative group has been brought together under Tom Arthur to look at how we go forward with NDR. In terms of the 10%, I don't know, is that something we maybe come back to the committee on? But I would assume it was growth. Andrew?
Well, I think it's something we should come back to the committee on. It's contained in the SFC's estimates, and it's very roughly the figure that you get to by 28-29. So I think we should come back to you just on the nature of that.
Well, it's actually the figures between 23-24 and 26-27 I'm looking at, which is more than 10%.
Right. Well, I'm looking at 3374, which is in 28-29, which is also about 10%.
Yeah. 3437 by 26-27.
We'll write back with the detail of why we think that's increased, if that's okay.
Thanks, Camina.
Right, that's great, thanks. One of the points that's come up from a few questioners has just been the uncertainty in the UK government's budget setting on timing, and I think this has come to committee quite a lot. So, I suppose it's a request more than a question, but, you know, can you press the UK government? I know you can't dictate to them. But, you know, if we had consistency every year as to when their budget is, so that we could then build on their budget and then local governments and everybody else
I will
come
make
afterwards.
That point. Yes, it doesn't help. It's really very, very challenging all round. I guess the commitment I will make is to, you know, engage with this committee as early and as much as I can through the budget setting process for 24-25.
That's great. Thanks very much. Well, can I thank you, Deputy First Minister, and your officials for your evidence today. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which will be taken in private, is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care on a proposed contingent liability. So we now move into private session.